Rumble weekend, Super Bowl Sunday. Let's fucking talk about it, dude. Hey, what's going on, everyone? My name is Arx Manor. We're talking about Royal Rumble weekend. Ladies and gentlemen, it's gone and passed, and we're already headed on to the road to Elimination Chamber, already halfway there. I believe it's next week. And I got the good old co-host Kieran here.
Hello.
And we're gonna just hang out and we're gonna talk Royal Rumble weekend. So would you like to start with the Rumble or the Takeover?
We'll start with Takeover. Takeover is classed as a smaller show at the end of the day, so
okay.
We'll go with NXT.
NXT Takeover San Antonio. Mr. Kieran, what'd you think about it?
Solid pay-per-view. Areas for improvement, especially in the women's division.
Oh, yeah. Honest.
Huge areas for development. Shock with the loss of Shinsuke Nakamura.
Yeah, man, that was huge to me. That was huge. Like, when I watched it on my Snapchat story, I had so many people reply to it being like, why are you so into this? And I was moving my phone. I was like jumping up and down. I was sitting back in my chair as I was, watching that match live. And it was so amazing to just see the whole experience happen. But let's start at the top of the card. It was Ty Dillinger versus the leader of Sanity.
Eric Young.
I was thinking Darren Young. And I was like, what? Wrong? Wrong Young there. But yeah.
Hold on.
This match was good. It had its moments.
Solid, just it had its interference as usual.
It was a Ty Dillinger match, which, you know, it's not to say that that's a bad thing, but it's the usual Ty Dillinger that we're expecting nowadays because, you know,
I mean,
Ty Dillinger's
we're
so
expecting
over
Ty to always lose now in NXT.
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. He's a fantastic athlete, but there's always going to be something that screws him over.
I didn't watch Raw SmackDown besides like a few clips. Is he on one of those shows now?
No, he isn't.
What the hell? Is he still down on NXT?
He has not been called up yet.
Ah, damn it! So we're getting a Zayn case here.
Have you seen the major call up that's happened on Raw?
Oh yeah, yeah. I saw that clip. I saw Joe.
Yeah,
oh man,
you saw Joe. That's fine. Mm-hmm. That's the only call up that's happened.
Wow.
For me, I think Ty Dillinger will get called up Raw after Mania.
Oh yeah. Same experience for Raw, kind of same, somewhat same experience for Zayn last year.
Yeah.
Yeah, Ty Dillinger, Eric Young, great opener to the night. And then I believe, jog my memory, I couldn't find the results for this one. What was the match after that?
I think it was DIY versus the Authors of Pain.
It might have been, actually. I think it was, but if it wasn't...
Or was it Roderick Strong?
Oh, no, Roger Strong. It was Roger Strong. Roddy Strong. Because I remember I was watching that live, and I was just like, Mr. ROH himself... competing in the WWE for once.
That was the only match of San Antonio I never actually watched. I'm not interested in either athlete at the minute.
Really, dude? You don't like Roderick Strong?
I just haven't clicked.
Oh, just wait, dude. Once they give him his strive, then he's gonna go running. I see clear-cut NXT champion in him in the future, but I do have the results now, and it was the Roddy Strong match. Dude, both of these guys were great performers in the ring. Roderick Strong, he's a phenomenal performer in the ring. He just needs a great gimmick. Andrade, he is also phenomenal in the ring. He just needs a better gimmick.
He does need a better gimmick. I preferred his face gimmick to his heel gimmick by a long shot.
Yeah.
I liked how he was a bit cocky when he was face.
Yeah, I don't know. When it comes to Almas, he's a male stripper. He's a true. Male stripper. How am I supposed to get behind a male stripper? I know there are a lot of people, like good old JD from New York, and I heard Joe Cronin's hopping on the Almas train as well. But I'm still not on the Andrade Cien Almas train because I just can't get over the male stripper gimmick. He's a great performer in the ring. I love him for his work in the ring. But when he's on his knees, like, praising the crowd like this, he's a heel. Two, he's a male stripper. He's trying to get money from you because he's showing off his body in a WWE ring. Come on, that's not... If something like Tyler Breeze and The Ascension didn't get over with Vince, how is Almas supposed to get over with Vince? Are you kidding me?
Yeah. I understand what you mean.
Anyways,
by a long shot.
Roddy Strong defeats Andrade Cien Almas at the end of that. Looked very, very strong in that. I loved it. Then it was DIY and Authors of Pain, which I didn't see this coming. I know we briefly talked about this the week before Rumble, but I didn't see the Authors of Pain taking the title so early.
I did. I don't think they're gonna pull a situation where they're gonna lose yet. Like, they've been really strong, and they've just come out of winning the Dusty Rhodes tag team classic, was it?
Yeah.
And yeah, I couldn't see them losing at this point because they're such on a roll at the minute. Mm-hmm. But I feel sorry for DIY because DIY haven't held the titles for too long. They had one successful defense against the MSX1 and the Revival. That's all they got. Oh no, they didn't even defend against the Revival, did they?
I don't know if they did. I don't remember. I
can't remember now.
correct me if I'm wrong, but they won it back in October?
Yeah.
That was when Toronto happened. Yeah.
Yeah,
I think that's fine. That's fine for DIY. I mean, they're gonna have a good run at the tag titles up until they get called up to whichever show, which I believe I really don't know at this point. I mean, the SmackDown tag team division is flourishing with the talent that they have, and Raw has even more talent. But they just don't know how to use it, so I don't know where they would go.
Raw doesn't know how to use it, while SmackDown has superstars that have been used in like the past year or 2 years as jobbers, e.g. the Ascension of Raw villains.
Mm-hmm. I really liked what I saw in the clips of the Ascension that I saw on SmackDown. By the way, I think they're gonna get a really cool repackaging. They might get like a whole Usos type of deal. By the way, the Usos still look amazing to me.
The Usos have been phenomenal since their heel turn.
Mm-hmm. DIY gets defeated by the Authors of Pain. Not so smoothly as we thought. As most people thought. But, you know, regardless, Authors of Pain did go over and win the NXT Tag Team Championships. And then right after this match...
The women's match.
No. We're not talking about that yet. That segment. They played off so well too. Seth Rollins took over an NXT takeover and called out Triple H.
That made me laugh so much. commentators were talking.
Very well done.
Just when you saw Corey Graves turn his face, like, what the hell are you doing?
It makes you think, was that planned? Which, of course, it was. But
it was planned.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That entire segment itself was gold, in my opinion. I apologize. My sinuses are all out of whack right now. I don't know why all of a sudden it is, but either way.
Just thinking, while Seth Rollins is currently brought up, how are you feeling now he is injured?
here's my thing about Rollins being injured, okay? Think about what happened last time he was injured with that knee. Just think about it. He got very little publicity. We heard literally nothing from Rollins until he returned in May and we got the WWE 24 documentary. So then, why in this situation he gets footage of him walking out of the arena on crutches? He gets pictures of him walking into a limousine. He gets pictures on Twitter. He gets publicity all around the WWE. Why is this one so huge? Why is this one so wide across social media? Why is this...
It's probably because they want to try and keep the rivalry between him and Triple H.
But what if it's just a kayfabe injury? What if this is just a quote-unquote injury that just keeps Rollins out till Mania?
I don't think it is at all.
And
do you see?
Don't forget.
Did you see the clip?
Yeah, I did. That was intense.
No, I mean, like, with Samoa Joe actually asking Rollins, "Are you okay?" And he turns around and says, "I hope so."
Oh, I didn't. That was a clip.
You couldn't really see Samoa Joe talk, but you could see Rollins reply, and by lip reading, he says, "I hope so." And I do think it was a real injury, but it's nothing major. Just think it needs a bit of time.
I still think we're going to get Triple H Rollins at Mania. People were talking that we're going to get... I don't remember who it was. There was someone else in the works. I think it was like Angle Hunter. I wouldn't want that. I wouldn't be a fan of that.
I wouldn't be a fan of that. I just think the story's perfect at the minute for it to be Rollins, Triple H.
That's why I think there's a big, huge work that could refuel the flame for this rivalry, because with what they have done, I mean, realistically, think about it. They could have done this for Survivor Series. It would have made Survivor Series feel even bigger than it was. This didn't have to be a Mania match. It could have been round two at Mania. You know, you didn't have to wait 7.5 months just to have a rivalry that was practically dead to be revived by this moment. Do you really want to talk a lot about the women's match? I mean, Asuka, of course, defeated all the other contenders.
I don't really want to. It was quite...
Nikki Cross looked really good. Peyton Royce and Billie Kay looked fine. Asuka looked great. Asuka going over all the other competitors. Of course, this is all building up to NXT TakeOver Orlando. And TakeOver Orlando is going to be Asuka versus Ember Moon. Ember Moon is going to take the title. Asuka's going to go up. That's how it goes down. Simple-ass booking.
I'd be fine with that. I'd be completely fine with that.
Yeah, Ember Moon's a phenomenal performer.
Yeah. As soon as Ember Moon debuted, I was like, she's going to be one to dethrone Asuka. And it is going to happen.
She's gotten a special little thing with her, and I'm really digging it. Now the main event of NXT TakeOver. San Antonio, Bobby Roode versus Shinsuke Nakamura, and two of the most amazing, nay, glorious entrances of all time.
So very true. The thing is, it's very hard. It's like AJ Styles with Bobby Roode. It's so hard to make him a heel because he's so over with the fans. He's just got that catchy song, hasn't he?
Yeah, it was like, I'm sorry. I'm like a lot of the classic, the old time guys. See guys like us and a lot of other guys cheering on the heels as like people that overthrow the shows, you know, like those guys that want to break kayfabe per se. I don't really see it as that. I just cheer for the guys that really deserve the cheers at the moment. Like in the match, you don't see Seth Rollins and his heel work. He would get cheers when he did some amazing moves. Of course, you know, that any sort of amazing move garners cheer from a crowd. Doesn't matter if they're face or heel. now the work of the character, whether they play it off like, oh yeah, I'm a bad guy. You know, Kevin Owens does a great job of that. Whenever he does a great move, gets a lot of cheers, he looks at the crowd, Usher, like, he, like, points out, like, yeah, I'm gonna go for it again, runs in, stops, and then just does, like, a super kick, you know? That's, like, some great heel work. That's, like, wow, you teased us, you know? That's, like, the type of thing that you gotta do as a heel, to get over as a bad guy. But I think Bobby Roode does great, great in-ring work, along with Shinsuke Nakamura. This match alone. Oh, man.
Great match. Great character work. Great selling from Shinsuke to sell the injury as well.
This match alone, it felt like a Mania match, you know?
It could be a future Mania match. You'd never know.
Or a Mania rematch from NXT TakeOver San Antonio. We could be witnessing history right here, right now. A lot of people speculated that Nakamura was going to be... I believe we speculated that Nakamura was going to be in the Rumble.
I think after I saw that injury, I knew it wasn't going to happen. A lot of fans thought, oh, now he's lost, it'll be in the Rumble. When I saw the injury, I was like, if he's going to sell the injury, then he shouldn't be in the Royal Rumble. Otherwise, it's just made it all a bit pointless to make that injury.
Yeah.
So I think it was perfect selling, which is why he wasn't there.
And if we're talking all of our main three predictions that we're going to be in the Rumble, Dillinger, Joe, and Nakamura. Nakamura, you know, you just said he sold that injury so well. Joe was in the crowd. He was in the audience of TakeOver, which is clear cut, like, oh yeah, I'm heading up soon. Bye, guys. You know, why couldn't he be number 30? We'll get to that in a little bit. And, you know, Ty Dillinger coming out number 10. Oh my god, I popped so bad. Like I wish I got Rumble footage moment. Of it.
Rumble moment.
Uh huh. Of the whole night. Like, I heard the music and I was like, wait. This can't be. This can't be. And it hit the beat dropped and you just hear 10. And chills ran down my spine.
I have to admit, I fist bumped so hard at that.
10, 10, 10, 10.
They actually pulled it. And I loved how for the 10th countdown, the crowd, instead of counting down, they were going 10, 10, 10, 10 each one. So it was like the perfect build for Ty.
Yeah. Either way, though, Bobby Roode goes over Shinsuke Nakamura in a great NXT Championship match. If you don't believe us, guys, please, please go check out this matchup. There are no words that can do it justice. If WWE was looking to top Okada Omega, this could have been a very, very big contender for it.
And now we should move on to the Rumble.
Yeah, let's just move right on into the Rumble, dude.
I want to bring up one thing with the pre-show. And that's
is it the tags?
Titles.
Yeah.
The
I didn't only expect thing I want to bring them up. To win, dude. I did not expect them to win that match.
I just didn't expect WWE to pull the plug.
I'm shocked that we now have Gallows and Anderson as, like, this worldwide phenomenal tag team, which is great, honestly. But if you think about it, how long will they have it?
Until Mania. I'm making a prediction right now. It'll be the club putting their titles on the line against Enzo and Cass Mania.
Ooh.
And I would love to see that as well.
That would be awesome.
It's about time they start pulling the plug for Enzo and Cass, because, like, at the end of the day, Raw aren't using their tag teams very well, and this would be a great way to utilize Enzo and Cass, who haven't really been used very well as a tag team in that division, let's say.
Yeah, they've definitely been pushing it as they're gonna be split very soon.
Yeah. I would rather see them hold the tag team titles before they split.
Mm-hmm. And just to cover the pre-show, I didn't watch much of it. I didn't watch Jackson Banks or the six-woman tag match. But I did watch a bit of the tag title match, the Raw tag title match.
The only match I watched was Jackson Banks. Because time zones reasons, so I had to go to sleep. And by the time I woke up, I already missed two of the matches. So I only got to watch Jackson Banks.
Yeah. Cesaro and Sheamus, they looked really good, as well as the club, and just in general, like that match was pretty solid for a pre-show match. I really think it deserved to be on the main show.
I'm surprised
they could have given that spot to to a cruiserweight match. You know, other than
should have put it to Rich Swann and Neville, because
no,
in all honesty. No, the pre-show match should have been Rich Swann and Neville, because all honesty,
I disagree.
The tag titles are such bigger than the cruiserweight titles at the end of the day, and it should deserve a bigger card name than that.
But think about this. Think about it logically. Royal Rumble is supposed to be one of the big four pay-per-views of the year. The main show had count them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 matches, including the Royal Rumble. So you could have just tossed in the Raw tag titles onto the main show and toss on a cruiserweight match to get more cruiserweights on the show for the pre-show, you know? Because other than Rich Swann and Neville, we didn't see any cruiserweights. Jack Gallagher. But we didn't see any other cruiserweights all night. They were non-existent.
It would have been nice to see Cedric Alexander and Noam Dar.
Yeah. Their story, I'm still not a fan of at all. Cedric Alexander.
It would have made sense.
It would have. Big blow-off match. I really don't like how they're handling Noam Dar. They're giving him a good old Paige rub on me. Because Paige, man, do you remember how much potential Paige had?
I do.
Paige was clear cut, like it looked like she was going to be at WrestleMania 50. Now it looks like she deserved a spot at, well, WrestleMania 27. Either way, though, you know, all the pre-show matches, I'm sure they were great on their own. It looked like, beside the six-woman tag match, it looked like a strong pre-show for once in a while, seeing as we had Cesaro and Sheamus and the club and Sasha Banks all in the pre-show.
I'll be honest, Sasha Banks' match I did not enjoy.
Really?
Yeah. It was basically to get Jax over.
Oh, was it a squash?
Sasha's selling. It was a squash because Sasha had to sell an injury again.
Damn it.
So it was a squash and I hated it.
That sucks.
And now we shall move to the main card.
Oh yeah, let's go for it. Charlotte versus Bayley. It throws me off so much, man. Do not put Charlotte Flair. Do not put Charlotte Flair. We already know that she's the daughter of Ric Flair. We don't need a Flair at the end of that. Come on, man. God, she split from her dad like almost a year ago. So you can just be like, we don't need you anymore, Flair of the name. We don't need it. Yeah. Come on. But, you know, going into this, we all saw it happening. Charlotte was not going to lose her pay-per-view streak just yet.
It will happen at Mania.
Here's the thing, though. A lot of us are saying it's going to happen at Mania. What if another, like, screwy finish happens and it doesn't happen at Mania, but it gets up to 16?
I thought it was at 16.
No. It's at, like, counting the Rumble, I think it's at 13?
I thought it was at 16.
No, I could have sworn it was at 12 after Roadblock.
I'm not sure. I feel Bayley's going to take it at Mania.
It'd be a great moment. I doubt they're going to do it.
I feel like Sasha's going to turn heel. And you'll get two heels versus the one baby face. A bit like the Daniel Bryan story. Not obviously exactly like it, but where Bayley basically will win in a triple threat against Sasha and Charlotte at Mania. That's my prediction.
Whoa, wait a second.
I'm listening.
IWD, the Internet Wrestling Database, is telling me Charlotte Flair on pay-per-views has won 19 matches. Probably not all title matches, let it be. And one loss.
One loss. Is this an NXT TakeOver or something?
No. Well, it might count. Those might count, actually. I don't know. That's just the Internet Wrestling Database. But if you guys find anything otherwise, just go and comment down below what happened with that. But we all know going in, Charlotte's going to keep that pay-per-view record going. Bayley's probably going to take it to Mania, whatever that may entail. Charlotte's going to keep the title at Rumble.
Yeah.
And she did. She defeated Bayley. That was obvious.
She did.
Yeah. Interesting choice here. The second match of the night was the Universal Championship match. This didn't have any sort of feel on me like the WWE World title being halfway through the card at SummerSlam. But it was still like a bit odd to see the Universal title match, the second match of the night.
Yeah, they should have waited and put it in the match before the WWE title match.
Like, move the Cruiserweight title above and then put the Universal title, then the WWE title, then the Rumble.
I know why they did it. It's because Reigns was 30 in the Rumble. They had to give him a bit of a rest. That's why they did it.
We'll get to that in a little bit. Yeah, we'll I'm still that, salty about
that's
it.
That's why they did it.
Yeah, but anyways, Kevin Owens and Roman Reigns went through a grueling no disqualification match with Chris Jericho being suspended above the ring in a shark cage. You know, we also saw a great Superman punch with the brass knuckles from Kevin Owens.
That was brilliant.
That was so well thought out.
Why did he kick out? Why can he not sell?
Somewhere, somehow, William Regal was watching that and he cried. William Regal was disappointed in you, WWE. You're disappointed in the classic. It's
William Regal's most powerful weapon, the brass knuckles. Oh, God, that takes me back.
What they really should have done was just let the brass knuckles be its own thing. You didn't even need to implant Braun Strowman yet. You could have just let it be a Raw after Rumble thing. It could have just stopped at the brass knuckles. It really could have.
Yeah, basically.
I guess
what did I say about Braun Strowman getting the push?
This is not a good idea. Not a good idea at all.
What did I say though?
you did call it, but not a good idea at all, man. They're gonna feed him to Reigns. Reigns is gonna have a feast on Braun Strowman.
I've heard rumors that at Mania it will be Taker versus Reigns, but we'll get into that later.
Oh, it's definitely gonna be Taker and Reigns. But yeah, Kevin Owens defeats Roman Reigns due to a outside distraction, to say the least, by Braun Strowman. And you know, Owens retains the title, and this isn't the last time we see Roman Reigns. The next matchup on the card, Neville versus Rich Swann for the WWE Cruiserweight Championship. This was a solid match on its own. I don't care what you think about it, but what'd you think about it?
I don't care what you think about it, but what do you think about it? Just put that into quote marks for you, Robbie.
Please do.
No, I really did like it. It's
really
solid. It's probably one of the best matches since the Cruiserweights got pushed up to the main card.
Definitely.
It's by far brilliant. And Neville, of course.
Neville, the king of Cruiserweights! Oh, man. God, I can't think he's dropping it
anytime soon.
I cannot wait to see him defend it at Royal Rumble 2018 in Philadelphia. It's going to be great.
I reckon that could be a pull, though. Like, I reckon they might keep it on him for a year.
Oh, yeah. They're going to keep him on him. They're going to keep it on until Mania 34, then maybe drop it off him. But
yeah, I think he's going to have it for a while. It up its prestige a bit.
Neville is definitely going to be the longest reigning cruiserweight champion for a long time.
Do you want to make an early prediction on who you think will take it off him, though?
Who's going to take it off him?
Early prediction.
Since I'm predicting like a year in advance, I'm hoping and praying that at that point, WWE signs good old Kota Ibushi.
Ooh. Okay.
That'd be a great thing to see. Imagine WrestleMania 34, Neville versus Kota Ibushi.
Did Boom. Not expect that.
What do you think? Who do you think is going to take it?
I think it will take a second attempt. I think Jack Gallagher.
Oh. I can see that. I
think it will take a second attempt. But I think later on this year they'll face and Jack Gallagher will lose. But then he will still keep getting push further and he'll have another go at it and later on, like, start next year and take it.
Here's my thing about it. They're building like fantastic talent like Lince Dorado as jobbers. I don't see Lince Dorado being anywhere near the Cruiserweight Championship, which is sad because in the Cruiserweight Classic he was amazing.
He was.
But I haven't seen much from I don't even remember his fucking name. The guy that was in the final with TJ Perkins.
God damn, it's gone from my head.
Yeah! Like, we haven't seen him on television in weeks! Where's he at, dude? He was, like, the second best cruiserweight on the show!
Was it another mask, man? I'm not sure anymore.
Oh, he had a mask.
It was Lince Dorado, and there was another.
Oh, we're gonna be stuck on this all night, dude.
Yeah, let's move on before we
might yeah, end. Yeah, but, either way, Neville's the new cruiserweight champion, the king of the cruiserweights. Let's move on.
AJ Styles and AJ Big Mac, Johnny Cena.
Styles versus John Cena. And I just remembered this. Might as well throw it in now. For some fucking reason. I'm not even kidding you. If you go back and watch the Rumble, I believe I did write it down. Every champion came out first. Why?
I don't know.
Why did every champion come out first? I noticed it, especially with this match. Because with that long-ass ramp, and I heard Styles' music first, and I was like, what the flying fuck? Are you kidding me? Are you actually kidding me? AJ Styles comes out as the champion before John Cena. Come on, WWE.
I don't know why, but I guess, yeah.
Makes no sense to me. But either way, regardless, that had nothing to do with the matchup. The matchup was
fantastic. It was fantastic.
Dude, it's honestly, that's like the closest thing that they've got to Omega and Okada.
It is. And we just mentioned about Bobby Roode and Shinsuke. Like, this was probably tipping it better. Just, like, the story in that one match was fantastic. And the amount of no-sells, like, we always complain at WWE for not, like, selling finishes, but, God, they utilized that perfectly.
Mm-hmm. Like, here's my thing about it. Do you watch a good amount of New Japan at all?
Not really. Not much at all.
Okay. This match gave me a New Japan feel a whole lot.
I heard that was a thing, because...
Because so, he, here's what they did...
New Japan do a lot of, like, no-sells, like, mm-hmm. no-finisher sells or something.
Here's what they did with Omega and Okada. It took Kazuchika Okada, his big finisher called the Rainmaker... Which is essentially, like, the way I see it, like, a Superman punch, if you want to think of, like, an equivalent of that. A simple move, but it's built as this dominated move. Something like, it's basically a roll-around clothesline. Okada, you know, grabs the wrist from the inside, whips him around, gets a big clothesline on him. That's a clothesline from hell right there. But It took Okada 3 Rainmakers to put Omega down. And to think that Okada usually ends the matches with a Rainmaker. Okada pulled out a Rainmaker, I believe, halfway through the match. And then he pulled out again and again and again. It took him so many chances to do the do the Rainmaker to win the match. And that's the way that they built the Styles Clash and the Attitude Adjustment as well. And the thing I love about Omega and Okada was that they didn't use the One Winged Angel, which, completely off subject, the One Winged Angel is absolutely amazing, and I'm so glad that's like the one finish that's protected in New Japan. Going back to WWE, Styles and Cena, both what they threw at each other were equally strong in their own right, and they were equally great, and they just came back and forth, and this was by far better than their SummerSlam match to me.
And their SummerSlam match was great.
Yeah, it was like, that was a 4.5 out of 5-star match for me, and I think this is a 5-star match for me.
It's a 5-star match for me. Like,
this was an amazing
Dave
match.
Meltzer, but I don't know what Dave Meltzer put himself.
I don't remember. I listened to what he had to say about the match. Of course, he said it was phenomenal. no pun intended there.
No pun intended, but it's true.
It's very true. But I don't remember him saying a grading for the matchup. But either way, Cena looked very, very strong. And if anything, this is saving the name of AJ Styles for being toppled by an Elimination Chamber loss. John Cena, I could easily see as a great transitional champion. Even though his 16th championship reign won't be remembered as much, it will always be remembered for this phenomenal match. It doesn't have to be. Because
it's been a long time since I actually popped for John Cena.
Mm-hmm.
And how good he wrestled. Like, that was amazing. Like, that match.
Also, his heelish acts in the match that got me going.
Lines, Jesus Christ.
He had so many believable, like, facial expressions.
Mm.
I thought, if it's any time, 2017 is the time to pull the trigger on John Cena going heel.
Yeah.
This will be interesting.
The heelish stuff was sort of coming out a bit. Like, especially when he was building up those clotheslines and he looked absolutely furious.
Mm-hmm. And then Styles would still kick out of it, and then he'd look even more furious. That was so great. I didn't know Cena still had it in him.
I tell you, that flip move he does, that he did with Styles, that's probably the best I've ever seen him do it as well.
Oh, that was by far the best one. All the ones he tried to do with Owens failed miserably. All the ones he tried to do with any sort of match that he had while he had the US title for the open title match failed miserably. This one...
That was amazing.
This one was amazing. He executed that flawlessly. He just jumped on... Boom! Flipped them right on his back. It looked amazing. I'm a huge fan of that move, as long as he can do it correctly.
Like that,
often, It doesn't have to be one of the main moves that he performs every match. It just could be, a move every once in a while. Like, once he knows, like, I have to pull this out of my bag. Like a Hurricane Rana. Like, when he used it against Punk that one time.
That double AA finish, like when he rolled over,
mm-hmm,
flipped him back up. I thought that was great as well.
That was beautiful. That was great on Cena's behalf.
Never seen John Cena use that kind of athleticism in a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So there we go. We know he's still got it in him.
Yep. Okay. My goofy glasses are coming off for the good old end of the match. End of the night. I was wearing them that whole review, and wow, it is way brighter than I thought it was. Anyways, end of the night, the 30 superstar Royal Rumble match.
Oh, where do we start?
We went in this so excited because it was so unpredictable. It was so unpredictable. It was so exciting to be a WWE fan at that point. Little did we know. Anyways. The first two out were Big Cass and Chris Jericho. Definitely could not predict that. I did not predict those being the first two. Then again, the promo that they had at the beginning of the Rumble, Cass and Enzo, not surprised that they were the first ones out there, because that was a long, that was probably the longest promo on the main roster.
Yeah, I mean, it made sense, because to get the promo out of at least one of them.
Shit, man, that promo was about as long as that ramp.
But I'll be honest, Chris Jericho at number two could have been predictable, because he's been number two so many times now.
Really?
Yeah, 2012,
I think.
2012. Yeah.
That was it, because Ziggler came out and he was like, "Just send him out already." And then Jericho came out.
Yeah. I remember 2003. He chose number two to annoy Shawn Michaels, basically. Mm. I remember that well. He's been a two a few times, so it could have been a bit predictable.
I did not know that. But, you know, then the first, you know, essentially like the first 10 guys you could really skip over. It was nothing super exciting. We got like the Mojo Rawlings.
First 9. 10.
Yeah. First. Well, I mean like, here, I'll say like the first 8, not counting Jericho and Dillinger, okay? The first 8 other guys, you know, Cass, Raleigh, Mark Henry, those type of guys that we knew weren't going to win the match. Those type of guys came out first. Braun Strowman did come out that early, though. I forgot about that. Gallagher had a good spot Zane. with the umbrella. Zane was not first 10.
He was before Ty Dillinger.
He was number 8. Shit, you're right. And Strowman was number 7. Strowman was number seven. Disregard what I said. That was a stupid statement. I thought it was filled with guys like Mojo Rawley, like Kalisto, stuff like that.
I understand what you mean, don't worry.
But yeah, wow, that makes it like evenly divided. Now, if only we could have gotten like a Lesnar in like the teens, you know. But we'll get to that in a little bit. But, you know, of course, Ty Dillinger gets number 10. We got a Zayn at number 8. Strowman number 7, Cass and Jericho at 1 and 2. Yeah, I believe number three was Kalisto.
Yeah, I can't remember 4.
That was Mojo Rawley.
I think, was it Mojo? 5.
Mm-hmm. Could have been Henry. Oh no! 5 was Gallagher.
Wasn't it Gallagher?
Yeah, Gallagher. And then 6 was Henry. Then
7 Strowman.
8 was Zayn. 9 was someone.
Who was 9?
I don't remember who number 9 was. Maybe they have it on the site.
I don't remember who number 9 was.
Either way, though, the whole Rumble came down to essentially, you know, the bottom 5, which what we knew it was going to be. It really, like, we knew it was going to be, like, those 5 people. Like, you know what 5 I'm talking about.
Mm.
You got your Goldberg, your Lesnar, those type
your
of people.
Taker.
Your Taker, yeah. all
the
this going down.
We all hated.
Oh, my God. Number
30.
Fucking, okay. We're doing this late at night. And no one's home right now, so I can shout this at the top of my lungs. Number fucking 30! Roman fucking Reigns! You know, this pissed me off especially, because I didn't get it on footage or anything, but I heard, like, the two first, like little strums of the big old guitar for the big dog in his theme music, and I thought it was Balor's music. I really, like, I was hoping so much for Balor. I was like, fuck, yes, they did it. They actually did it. Nope. It was Roman Reigns. Once I realized it and I heard the music stop, and I was like, no. Burn him. No. And then I just pissed the whole time.
I was annoyed more in the fact that he already had a world title match.
That's unprecedented. A world title match contender never goes into the Rumble. Never goes into the Rumble.
The only time it ever went into the Rumble was 2005, and that's because Kurt Angle stole a number of someone else.
I believe it was one of those like instances where a guy came out and then Angle come out. It came out and like knocked him out or something like that.
Well, no, I remember it. It was Angle lost his match before the WWE title, so he got really annoyed. Saw Nunzio, took Nunzio's number, and walked away with his number.
Hmm.
It worked. Yeah.
Oh, but real quick, this. Lesnar being eliminated before we get into Reigns bullshit. Lesnar being eliminated even quicker than the Survivor Series match.
I know.
That was crazy. You see,
I have high levels of respect for Lesnar. If he's going over at Mania, then high levels of respect.
But here's the thing, though. The way I see them booking this match, if you think of it logically, you know, I'm seeing this as, like, logically what could happen. I'm not thinking about, like, oh, yeah, Lesnar's going to get it, get the matches back at Mania. I'm not looking at it like that because it's, you know, kind of obvious. Think about it on a logical standpoint. Not only has Goldberg beaten you once at Mania from like, upwards of 10 years ago.
13, I think it is now.
He also demolished you in less than 2 minutes at Survivor Series. And he just demolished you again at the Royal Rumble.
In about 24 seconds of entry.
Yeah. What makes you think that you're worthy of facing this guy again at WrestleMania? Again. True. You know? I don't see the reasoning of why it makes sense to have another Lesnar-Goldberg match. Of course they're gonna give either one of them the title. And whoever doesn't have the title is gonna walk away with it.
Very true. I don't want to see it as a title match. Why? Really hope they don't. Because I don't want to see Brock with it. Again.
They have to give it to Brock.
I wouldn't mind seeing it with Goldberg, but I just don't want to see Brock have it again as a part-timer. Hell no. Not someone who's gonna show up every, like, third pay-per-view.
And you're saying Goldberg's any better? Goldberg's the definition of part-time!
I know, but I think Goldberg would show up more than Lesnar would.
You see, I'm on the same side of you. I'm on the same side as you because I hated that Lesnar was away with the title. But if you look at it, like, that's sort of like his gimmick. Like, his gimmick is he's a prize fighter. He only comes out for the big paying events. He only comes out for the big paying pay-per-views, which it added to his character, you know? It also added to the shock of seeing Brock Lesnar, added to the shock of seeing Paul Heyman. You know, that type of stuff was special back then. So I wouldn't mind seeing a universal title reign by Lesnar. Of course I wouldn't take it upon Lesnar to be there for every single pay-per-view. But then again, that could be that could be something that the universal title that sets the universal title away from the rest, you know. Yeah. The universal title needs something to set itself away from the WWE title and the Intercontinental title in the United States, so, you know, it has to be something special at this point. But all in all, at the very end of the match, before we get to the winner, Roman fucking Reigns not only came out at number fucking 30. At that point, Taker had come out at number 29 and had eliminated Goldberg.
Sammy.
And Sammy.
That was another, but I can't remember.
I don't remember either. Might have been Jericho.
Reigns eliminated Jericho.
Well, shit. Roman Reigns comes out and he eliminates The Undertaker. To The Undertaker looking at him with his fierce glance, as per usual. So, obviously, this is going to lead to some type of blow-off. And to my knowledge, we didn't see him at all on Raw. So, looks like we're going to see, I believe it's currently penciled in, Roman Reigns versus Undertaker for WrestleMania 33.
If they do it, I hope to God Taker wins. Because if Roman wins, I'm done, basically.
The way I see them doing it, here's the thing. The way I see them doing it, they don't see Undertaker's streak at Mania important anymore after losing at Mania 3 years ago. So at this point, really anyone could beat Undertaker and it wouldn't mean as much. And they want Roman to get over. Heel or not, but because here's the thing. Did you see his facial expression once he eliminated The Undertaker?
Yeah.
That was like the only positive thing about that. It was an okay facial expression. Had nothing on John Cena's expression later on, or earlier on from the night. But when it comes to heel turn, this is it. This has got to be it. If we don't see a Roman Reigns heel turn when he goes up against Undertaker, I'm going to put my life savings on it. I'm going to put my right testicle on it. I'm going to put my firstborn child on it. We will never see a Roman Reigns heel turn.
We will never see what? Sorry?
We will never see a Roman Reigns heel turn. If we don't see it now for the build to road to WrestleMania, we're never going to see it.
That's if it's Taker Reigns.
It's got to be. Reigns
really
doesn't have the United States title.
I really wanted Cena Taker.
Reigns not gonna get the United States title to fall back on to have another match with, say a Braun Strowman. So you have that type of blow off match for the United States title. He doesn't have that to fall back on, which would have been a superb match for WrestleMania in my eyes.
Yeah.
When it all comes down to it, Randy Orton won the Royal Rumble. There are in talks for a Bray Wyatt versus Randy Orton for Mania for the WWE title. In my eyes, they could have done it flip-flopped. Bray Wyatt won the Royal Rumble, which would have I would have popped so bad. I would have marked out so intensely bad if Bray Wyatt would have won. I believe you did. I remember hearing you say that.
I've always wanted Bray Wyatt to win the Rumble.
Yeah, man. Bray Wyatt winning the Rumble would have been so amazing. And Orton winning the Elimination Chamber. I don't believe he's ever won an Elimination Chamber. That would have been an unprecedented thing. Because if you think about it, this year, Orton made it twice. Last year, Triple H made it twice. The year before that, Roman Reigns fucking won. The year before that, Batista made it twice. The year before that, John Cena made it twice. What the hell? We need new winners.
What did I say last week? They're going to make it twice.
I hate you. I hate you. But either way, going into...
make it twice. I thought it would have been Taker. But I didn't.
I'm glad it wasn't Taker, man.
I told you they would make it twice.
Taker doesn't need the Mania win. Someone else could have used it. Bray Wyatt could have used it.
I know, but I told you they were going to do it twice.
Yeah, you did. Okay, going into Mania, the main title picture looking like Randy Orton versus Bray Wyatt for the WWE title.
If Bray wins at the Elimination Chamber.
Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me, dude?
I don't have so much faith in WWE.
Miz and Ambrose are not winning.
Cena could win. Still. It's his 16th reign. You got that factor to count in, but no one wants to see Randy Cena for like the 10 millionth time. You've got.
But then you'd Aaron see Corbin it again. Shout. Wait. Time out. If Cena won the Elimination Chamber, he would keep the title, but he would also go to Mania as the champion and face Orton again.
Yep.
Cena's not winning that Elimination Chamber. He's already won enough. He won the 2010 Elimination Chamber and the 2006 Elimination Chamber. He doesn't need a third Elimination Chamber.
Well, yeah, well, we'll see. I'm not confident. I want it to be Bray.
It's got to be Bray. For the Universal title, I see, honestly, Lesnar, Goldberg. Goldberg's going to take it off Owens at Fastlane. And it's going to be Lesnar, Goldberg for the Universal title.
I'm going to go off on a limb here purely because I don't want to see him part-time hold the belt. I think Mania, Universal title, Owens, Strowman.
Oh, no!
I'm not joking. I'm not joking.
No.
And I think it would be awful. Look at the past few WrestleManias. They haven't been great. And I don't think it's going to match up any same.
Past few? What are you talking about? Mania 31 was great. The only match that wasn't... Oh, yeah, last year's was not. But Mania 31 was great besides the Sting-Triple H match.
I didn't enjoy 31. I really didn't. I'll be honest.
Mania 30. Mania 30.
Right.
Okay, I was about to say, come on, dude. Let's be honest.
Whole Daniel Bryan story.
Oh, yeah, man. But when it comes down to Mania 33... not shaping out to be the best WrestleMania in the world, especially if Rollins is legitimately injured, and especially if we do legitimately get a John Cena Randy Orton match again, and especially
a second option.
What is that?
Finn Balor could be cleared by then. Just saying.
Here's my thing about Balor. I don't want to see him anywhere near the Universal Title Belt until after Mania now.
Fair.
Because he, in my eyes, the time to go for it was the Rumble. Balor wins the Rumble. You know, I would have taken a Balor win if, you know, Goldberg and Taker were tied up in the ropes and someone. It could have been anyone to come and eliminate them together. Not one by one, together.
Biggest pot. Like,
imagine if, like...
Could you imagine? Like, I was thinking, like, could you imagine if someone like Sami Zayn managed to pull that off?
Oh, man.
Like...
The best Rumble, in the history of the Royal Rumble, then, right there. Just on based upon that singular moment.
It's like, I remember they tried to do quite a similar thing a few years ago. I think it was the 2010 Rumble. It was Big Show and Mark Henry tangled on the ropes, and R-Truth did it. Eliminated them both.
Oh!
Like someone quite small to eliminate both.
Yeah, you're right. I do remember that. R-Truth did eliminate those two huge monsters.
In one go, as soon as he walked in.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, what if they could do that again?
That'd be awesome. But either way, Randy Orton's for sure going to be in the main event of WrestleMania. Or one of them, seeing as WWE is the way that WWE is. Yeah, we can get more into WrestleMania 33 the next time we get into it, but we're coming up on time here for the Zooming Through Wrestling podcast. Again, I want to apologize that this is a day late, but, you know, either way, hope you guys are satisfied with the video. Kieran, I want to thank you so much for stopping by on the show.
That's fine.
Anytime. Yeah, that's about it for your Royal Rumble weekend overview and review. And that will be it for the podcast. I want to thank you guys so much for watching this video. If you guys liked it, please leave a like down below. Show your support. Comment down below. What was your favorite part of the podcast? What could we improve? What else? Subscribe for great content. I'll see you guys in the next one. Do me a favor. Have yourselves a damn good day. And peace.